The National Weather Service is defending itself regarding the alerts that it issued and the timing of them. Christina Dahl, the vice president of Climate Central, addressed the role of staffing at NWS and other federal agencies and whether cuts are potentially impacting forecasts.
I think it's too early to say. We do know that the National Weather Service issued multiple warnings about flood risk, and so clearly they were getting messages out. They do have a vacancy right now in a critical position called the Warning Coordination Meteorologist. And so it could be that that vacancy had connections to local authorities who could have helped to raise early warnings for residents. But generally, a weather forecast office for the National Weather Service has someone on staff 24 hours watching the radar to see what is happening in terms of precipitation, rainfall, other threats. And there are National Weather Service offices throughout the country that, because of staffing cuts, are no longer staffing their offices 24 hours a day. And so we need these critical people to be keeping us safe 24 hours a day in every one of these offices across the country. And the second piece of this is that staffing cuts at NOAA, or the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, more broadly, are threatening the future ability to forecast events better. Forecasting a storm like this one, where exactly is the heaviest rain going to fall? How is it going to translate from rain into flooding? These are extremely challenging problems scientifically, and it's the research of NOAA that enables us to improve our forecasts year over year so that we can more accurately pinpoint the warnings that need to go out to the public.
Now, the very reports designed to warn us of these extreme weather risks have seemingly disappeared. Legally mandated national climate assessments, long used by state and local officials to prepare for climate impacts, have been quietly removed from federal websites. The White House says the info will now be housed within NASA. Joining me now, the man who helped build this very system that's now being taken apart, John Holdren. He's the co-director of the Science, Technology, and Public Policy Program at Harvard University's Belfer Center and a former science advisor for President Obama. Thank you so much for being with us on this holiday weekend. Let's start here. For viewers who might just be hearing about this, what exactly are these national climate assessments, and what does it mean that they've effectively vanished from federal websites?
Well, the national climate assessments of climate change impacts on the United States were mandated in a 1990 Act of Congress, the U.S. Global Research Act of 1990, and they are supposed to be produced roughly every 4 years. Some have been slow, but on the whole, there have been five such reports produced. The sixth was recently canceled in midstream by President Trump. And the five previous ones, which were all posted on the U.S. Global Change Research Program's website, have disappeared for the moment. They may show up on the NASA website. We can hope so. But the whole fiasco is simply one aspect of a campaign by the Trump administration to dismantle large parts of the U.S. research establishment. And in particular, to dismantle every effort to better understand and predict what climate change is doing in the United States.
Well, John, help me understand this a little bit more. You've warned that suppressing this kind of information could actually increase the danger Americans face from climate impacts. How does that work?
Absolutely. The national assessments have provided information about how climate is affecting every region in the United States and every sector of our economy. It's the only set of reports that are sufficiently detailed in those respects to be useful to decision makers, to city planners, to mayors, to governors, to tribal leaders, so that they can understand what steps they need to take in their domains to reduce the impacts of climate change on people, on property, on ecosystems, and on their local economies.
And now, John, you've called this just one front in a much broader assault on scientific analysis, as you were saying earlier, across climate, medicine, pollution, even public education. what's your sense of what's really driving this? And what might the long-term consequences be if this continues?
Well, it's of course very hard to see into the minds of the people, starting with President Trump, who are orchestrating this campaign against science and reason. But one has to assume that it's some mixture of a desire for total control, a desire to eradicate sources of independent analysis and opinion that might provide information counter to the policies that President Trump is trying to advance.
Well, it's fascinating, and I just appreciate you taking the time, especially out of a holiday weekend, to break all of this down and to really illustrate the importance of talking about this issue. John Holdren, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.